Today I want to look at the book of Acts, Acts chapter 1, and you know, a preacher preaches better when you help him. Now I don't need all the help in the world, but I do need some. Now, the Holy Spirit helps me, but if you stay awake, that's good help, number one. But you can give me a little talking back, you know, that's all right too. Acts chapter 1, and we're going to look here at a couple of passages together. Acts chapter 1, and we're going to look at verse 1, and then we'll look at Acts chapter 2 and verse 14. They're, of course, really, really close to each other. Acts chapter 1 here we see. In verse 1, it says, "The former account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach until the day in which he was taken up, after he through the Holy Spirit had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs." Actually, scripture says that there's 526 at least people who saw him after his resurrection. That's quite a testimony of his resurrection. And it says that he was seen by them during 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Then scripture says right here that he tells his disciples to wait for the empowerment of the Holy Spirit that's going to come upon them and enable them to be witnesses unto him all around the world. And then, of course, the Holy Spirit falls in Acts chapter 2, and people are filled with the Spirit of God. And then we see the Apostle Peter standing up and endeavoring to explain what has happened in the book of Acts chapter 2. They've been filled with the Spirit of God. They're full of God. They're speaking in new tongues. It's just a supernatural thing going on right there. And so Peter stands up and he preaches what is the first sermon in the New Testament church after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And so I'm going to read his sermon to you. Is that okay to read Peter's sermon to you today? In verse 14 of Acts chapter 2, it says, "Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, 'Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and heed my words. For these are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out of my spirit on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my men servants and on my maid servants I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. And it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves also know. Him being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God, you have taken by lawless hands, you have crucified and put to death, whom God raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be held by it. For David says concerning him," and this is prophetically years before Jesus came, "I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is at my right hand that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart rejoiced and my tongue was glad. Moreover, my flesh also will rest in hope, for you will not leave my soul in Hades, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life, and you will make me full of joy in your presence. Men and brethren, let me speak freely to you of the patriarch David," talking about King David, giant killer David, "that he is both dead and buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Therefore, being a prophet and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his body, according to the flesh, he would raise up the Christ to sit on the throne. His foreseeing this spoke concerning the resurrection of the Christ, that his soul was not left in Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God has raised up, of which we are all witnesses. Therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out that this which we now see and hear. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he says himself, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool.' Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Then Peter said to them, "Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call." Amen. The Apostle Peter here is setting the tone for the Christian church. He's setting the tone for the church that we are a part of right here. And he's saying the church of the living God is going to be a church filled with power. Amen. It's going to be a church that's filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. But it's also a church that's filled with the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And I believe that the church that he was talking about is a church that we are a part of. And so then we are a power-filled church. We are a spirit-empowered church. We are a church, a people of God, who are filled with his spirit and filled with the power of his resurrection. Praise God. Jesus said it this way in the book of Revelation chapter 1 and verse 18. He says, "I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death." I think it's pretty awesome that we have the opportunity and the privilege to be able to look to the back of our book and see the story and see the resurrection and see what Jesus says about himself. Praise God. He says at the end of this thing, he says, "I am the resurrection. I am the life. I am alive forevermore. I was dead, but I'm not any longer." Amen. One minister said it this way. He said, "Jesus was dead and all other gods are dead." Our living King is what sets us apart from every other religious persuasion, every other religion. We don't worship a dead God. We don't worship a building. We don't worship a memory of a good man. We don't worship a system of belief. We don't worship an individual. We worship the living God. We worship the King of Kings. We worship the Lord of Lords. Christianity is not just a systematic way to connect with God. It's not just a religious persuasion. It's not just a way to believe. It's not just how we do it because we live in the South. Christianity and our faith is found in a living God who sent his only begotten Son, Jesus the Christ, the anointed Son of God, to this earth. He sent him here, born of a virgin. He lived perfectly, holy, spotlessly, blamelessly, and was anointed by the Spirit of God. It did signs, wonders, miracles, raised the dead, made the blind to see, the lame to walk, cured the lepers. Praise God. When he showed up on the scene, miracles happened. Supernatural things happened. He spoke truth. He was truth. He was life. He was the way. He was the man God on this earth. And yet he went to the cross for the sin of all humanity. That's my sin. That's your sin. That's the mistake and shame of all people for all time, past, present, and future. And he paid the price for our sin, separation from God. He took stripes upon his back. He shed his blood on the cross of Calvary on the hill of Golgotha. He allowed himself to die. He was obedient to his Father and died the most punishable, brutal death you could die on a cross. But he rose again on the third day. He's alive forevermore. And this truth, this gospel, this good news, it transcends Methodism. It transcends non-denominationalism. It transcends Pentecostalism. It transcends Baptistism. It transcends come on, you know by now I'm gonna put an ism on all the end of these things. You know that, right? It transcends Presbyterianism. It transcends all religion. It is truth. Jesus is alive. He's raised from the dead, and our faith is in him. One minister said it this way. He said, "Death reigned supremely for 6,000 years, but Jesus defeated it in 3 days. My dad said it this way, fantastic. He said, "Jesus was the first man to enter the death experience and master it. He rose from the grave victorious. He rose from the grave triumphant. He rose from the grave in spite of all of hell itself. Every demonic host, every devil, every power trying to hold him down couldn't do it. He rose from the grave triumphant, alive forevermore. You know the devil was messed up when that happened. You know he thought he had it. You know he thought he won. You know he thought, come on, if he had known, Scripture says, he would not have crucified the Lord of glory. He didn't know. I mean, you think he would have had an idea with all the prophecies and all the things that Jesus had said, but he still thought he could get one over on God. He should have known after he got kicked out of heaven, you ain't getting one over on God. And that same power that knocked him out of glory, knocked the devil out of heaven, is the same power, hallelujah, that raised up Jesus in spite of all of the power of the enemy trying to hold him down. This is the God that we serve. This is the God that we serve. Jesus is a living king. What's amazing about his resurrection is not just that it happened, but that he called it. I said he called it. There's a number of times it says this in Scripture. I'll just read one of them to you. In Luke chapter 9, it says, the Son of Man, Jesus says this, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised on the third day. He's telling his disciples this while he's with them. And it says that he tells them this a number of times. Listen, this is going to happen. I'm going to be killed, but I'm going to be raised the third day. So he calls it. Now look, it'd be one thing to call your death. We could probably all do that. I'm going to die. I'm going to die one day. It's a whole nother thing to say what day you're getting back up. He didn't just say, I'm going to get killed. He said, I'm going to get killed, but it ain't going to be like you think. You don't need to sorrow. You don't need to weep. You don't need to act like this thing is over. It's amazing to me that the disciples weren't more prepared with expectation on that third day. But on that third day, just like he said it would happen, he rose again. Now the next step is this, is he not only called it for himself, he called it for you and for me. Jesus said this to one of the sisters of a man by the name of Lazarus who had been dead for 4 days. Jesus shows up. He says this to her. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? He says, look, what I am, who I am, and what I'm going to do is going to do more than just affect me. Do you know that Jesus didn't need to go to the cross for himself? He didn't need to be raised from the dead for himself. He was already victorious over the enemy. He defeated the devil, the enemy, and all the power of darkness for who? For you, for me, for us, so that we could be free from sin, so that we could be free from shame, so that we could be free from our past, so that we could be free from sickness and disease, so that we could be free from separation from God, so that we could live the full life that he has for us in Christ Jesus. And he's saying right here, he says, the resurrection and the life that I am is going to do more than just affect me. It's going to affect you. It's going to affect you. He says, do you believe this? Do I have any believers in the house that say, yeah, I'm here. I believe this. I believe Jesus is the resurrection and the life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's a living king. He's a living God. Aren't you glad to know that we serve a living God? A living God. Hallelujah. I found a few places in Scripture where he's called the living God. 1 Samuel chapter 17, the King David, Psalmist David, he says, for who is this uncircumcised Philistine, talking about Goliath, that should defy the armies of the living God? In Jeremiah 10 and verse 10, it says, but the Lord is the true God. He is the living God and the everlasting King. Said of Daniel, a man of God, it says in Daniel chapter 6, it says, the king spoke, saying to Daniel, Daniel, servant of the living God. In Matthew chapter 16, Simon Peter, when he responds to Jesus, he says, you are the Christ, the son of the Come on, y'all ought to know where I'm going. You're the Son of the living God. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, talking about us, it says, for you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God and they will be my people. Praise God. We are called to live alive in Christ Jesus because we serve a living God. And a living God does living things. A living God does living things. He does things like this. He hears us when we pray. He answers. He responds. He speaks. He loves. He gives. He moves. He helps. He directs. He heals. He reveals. He restores. Come on. He changes things. He turns things around. He brings us back to life again. We don't serve a dead God. We serve a living God. And because he's a living God and he's alive here and now and his presence is in this place and Jesus is raised from the dead, we get to enjoy the life that he has called us to live. I know you came just because it's Easter Sunday and it's Resurrection Sunday and you got all cute and you got all pretty, but you might ought to act like you're alive in this place, like Jesus is Lord, like heaven is your home, like you've been redeemed from your sin, like you've been brought out of darkness and brought into the light, like you've been changed, like you ain't who you used to be, like you're a new creation in Christ Jesus, that the same Spirit that raised him from the dead is that same Holy Spirit that's here, that's now, that's in Alexandria, Louisiana, that's working in your life, that's working in your family, that's working in your house, that knew you'd be here today, and no matter how much you jacked things up in your life, he still made a way for you. That's the God that we serve. He is a living God. We don't sing empty songs. We don't pray empty prayers. We have a God who hears, answers, responds, and moves in response to our faith in him. And he's awesome, and he's mighty, and he's alive, and he's real. It's not a fairy tale. It's not a cute story. It's not like a little something you can just tell your kids around Easter time. Like, well, we have Easter bunnies. We got chocolate. We got Easter eggs. And by the way, Jesus too. Look, we had Easter eggs yesterday. We ate chocolate Easter bunnies yesterday. But I'm telling you what, this Jesus changes everything. Only a living God can bring you to life again. Hallelujah. Only a God who tasted death for you can bring you back to life again. You can't get true life from dead places. Sad reality and truth is there's just so many people looking for life in dead places. You're not going to find the life you're looking for in any bottle. You're not going to find the life you're looking for in anything you could smoke. You're not going to find the life you're looking for in any individual person. You're not going to find the life you're looking for even in any marriage. You're not going to find the life that you're looking for with your kids being perfect and doing everything you told them to do and being perfect for the rest of their life. You're not going to find the life that you're looking for in any car. As soon as you get that car, you're going to find out it's just a car. You're not going to find the life that you're looking for in any house. As soon as you move into the house, you go, it's just another house. I'm still me and I'm in here. You're not going to find the life that you're looking for in any job or any place where you work. You go, well, now I'm really living life. The life that you are meant to live is only found in the one who created you. And the one who created you is the one who knows how to satisfy you. The one who created you is the one who knows how to fill you up. The one who created you is the one who knows how to satisfy your heart, your desire. Come on, there's something on the inside of you that desires the reality of true fellowship and communion with the creator of the universe. And I know it seems far-fetched, and I know it seems like, how is that possible? But the big creator, almighty God, Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end, desired fellowship and communion with you. And the only thing that separated you from him was your sin. And he removed that sin with Jesus, went to that cross so that through his cross, through his blood, and through his resurrection, there is a way that has been made for you and for me. And you didn't earn it. You can't pay for it. You can't be good enough for it. You can't be pretty enough for it, ugly enough for it, have enough money for it. You just got to believe in the goodness of an almighty God who made a way for you and for me. And this good news, it transcends culture. It transcends culture. It transcends every aspect of anything that would ever divide us. You look around a church like this today and you see there's a lot of people from a lot of different backgrounds, no doubt about it. How in the world can a church like this get together on a Sunday and not argue and not fight and not get mad at each other for whatever's happened in the past? How in the world can we get together? There is one who unites us, is far greater than anything or anyone who has ever divided us. His name is Jesus. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. Come on. He's the lily of the valley. He's a bright, shining morning star, and he is alive, praise God. And he calls people to himself from the north, the south, the east, and the west, from every race, from every tongue, whoever will call on him. What a good God. What a living God. What a living God we serve. The Apostle Paul was preaching to some people who worshiped a lot of different things. And they had one place that said to the unknown God, he said, I want to talk to you about the unknown God, the one you don't know. He says, that's the one you're missing out on there, because that's the real one. He's the creator of heaven and of earth. And he says this about him. He says, for in him we live, in him we move, and in him we have our being. That means without him, we got nothing. But with him, we got everything. Hallelujah. 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 I want to read this to you in Ephesians chapter 2 in the Message Bible, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. It says, it wasn't so long ago that you were mired in that old stagnant life of sin. You let the world, which doesn't know the first thing about living, tell you how to live. You filled your lungs with polluted unbelief and then exhaled disobedience. We all did it. All of us doing what we felt like doing, when we felt like doing it. All of us in the same boat. It's a wonder God didn't lose his temper and do away with a whole lot of us. Instead, immense in mercy and with incredible love, he embraced us. He took our sin-dead lives and made us alive in Christ. He did all this on his own, with no help from us. Then he picked us up and set us down in highest heaven in company with Jesus, our Messiah. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 13 in the Message, I want to read this to you as well. It says, when you were stuck in your old sin-dead life, you were incapable of responding to God. But God brought you alive right along with Christ. Think of it, all sins forgiven. The slate wiped clean, the old arrest warrant canceled and nailed to Christ's cross. He stripped all the spiritual tyrants in the universe of their sham authority at the cross and marched them naked through the streets. He says, you were stuck in a dead sin life, old way of living. You just did what you felt like doing because that's what everybody did. You did what everybody said to do because that's just what everybody said to do, and didn't really realize you were the walking dead. Didn't realize you were living, but you weren't really living. You had breath in your lungs, but not in your spirit. You were walking, but you weren't really living. He says, but when you were living that rebellious way, when you were just doing your own thing, God, who's rich in mercy, aren't you glad he's rich in mercy? With his great love with which he loved us. Oh, while we were still sinners, while we were still so far off, he says, God made a way for you. He raised you up. He didn't see you for who you were. He saw you for who you could be in him. You could be made alive. You could be made new. You could be forgiven. You could be redeemed. Praise God. This is how Christ sees us, through his death, burial, and resurrection. is how the goodness of God the Father sees us. And in John chapter 11, when Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and the life, he actually just says at the end of this conversation with the sister of Lazarus, he says, do you believe this? Do you believe this? It's a pretty simple response, right? Do you believe this? Sometimes the gospel, I've heard it said and I call it, it's the too good news. Like it seems too easy. Seems too simple, like to just get free from my sin, just get free from my mistakes and my past. All I gotta do is believe in this Jesus. All I gotta do is put my faith in him. The scripture says that's not our works of righteousness that we could be saved. I mean, there's still a lot of people who are trying to like work their way up to being good enough. I can remember when I was a youth pastor, we did a little poll of some students who were coming out of a high school. We asked them, what is it going to take to get to heaven? How are you going to know? And they just said, well, I really won't know. I don't think I can know. I'm just going to try to do enough good things. And if my good things outweigh my bad things, then I get to go to heaven. That's the thought. That's the thought. And there's a lot of people who still think like that. Like I'm trying to just be good enough. And if I can be good enough, or how about this? I may not be really, really great or really good, but I'm not as bad as they are. I'm not going to preach that too long because that'll mess you all up. But you know what I mean? Like I'm maybe not as good as so-and-so, but I know I ain't as bad as them. So maybe they'll go to hell, but not me. I'm a little better than they are, you know. And scripture just teaches there's none righteous, no, not one. Not a single person deserves to be right before God. And the first person who thinks they deserve to be right before God is now full of pride and therefore full of sin and therefore unworthy to stand before God. So what is our response to this good news? I think a lot of people don't accept it because they think about the next 20 years of their life, like how am I going to live it? Especially if you've been raised around church or raised around Christians, you're like, well, that's just a bunch of hypocrites. Like one preacher said it this way. So we got room for one more. Come on. It's not a church filled of perfect people because of themselves. It's a church full of people who've been washed by the blood of Jesus. The church full of people who still grow on it. It's a church full of people who still need the grace of God. I still need his mercy every single morning. I still need what he did for me in the death, burial, and resurrection to be alive and at work in my life every single day of my life. I'm not there because I got a microphone and I get to yell at you for 30 minutes. That's the grace of God. I'm blessed to be able to do it, but thank God. Oh, man, the Holy Spirit's moving in this place. David Allen. What's happening with the lights, bro? Was it the Holy Spirit or was it a dove? Was it? I should have played it off as an illustrated sermon somehow, and I tried, but. How hard is it to believe? How hard is it to take that step? Can I be real, like, brutally honest with you? It's not hard at all. You could have walked in this place as an atheist and say, I don't believe in God at all. Come in here, experience the presence of God, hear the truth of how he's made a way for you, and in just a moment, just have your heart and life changed right there and go, I believe. Say, well, then what? Well, there's probably a lot of then what's after that, but let's not worry about the then what's. Let's just walk it out one step, one day at a time. Scripture says it this way. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son does not have life. If you've got Jesus, listen, and you're in this place, we have a reason to celebrate like we've been celebrating today. We have a reason to shout and rejoice like we've been shouting and rejoicing today. I have a reason to yell and have the veins all pop out in my neck while I'm preaching. But if you're in this place and you say, well, I just walked in, somebody invited me, my family, maybe my mom made me come or whatever, but you don't know that you know that you know that Jesus is the Lord of your life, don't miss this opportunity. God went too far for you to not take a small step. He went too far. Amen. In just a moment, I'm going to give you a chance to respond. It's not going to be too complicated. And I'm not going to ask you to join our church, even though, yeah, one day I'd love for you to join our church, but that's not what this moment is about. I'm not going to ask you to promise me that you're going to come to church the next year and never miss a Sunday, even though I'd really appreciate that. I'm going to ask you to simply put your faith in Jesus. Will you bow your head and close your eyes with me for just a moment? Lord, I thank you for the opportunity that we have to serve you, the opportunity that we have to experience your goodness, your grace, your faithfulness. Thank you for the joy of being in your house, being in your family. Thank you for the joy of being able to get together on a Sunday like this Sunday. People from all parts of our community, our state, maybe people visiting from other states, family. I pray in this moment, Lord, that it's just such clarity concerning your plan and your purpose for people. I pray that we can see it clearer than we've ever seen it before. And I pray that, Lord, if those who are in here who are, they've heard this, they know this, they've been in the family of God for a long time, I pray that their spirits are stirred to be thankful for how good God has been, and stirred to live out the fullness of the life that they've received in Christ. But Lord, I pray for those who are here who maybe they're on the fringes, maybe they're unsure, but in this moment they're gonna make a decision for you. If you're here and you say, pray with me, I wanna make Jesus the Lord of my life. It's not complicated, it's not hard, it's pretty simple, but we're gonna do it together. On the count of three, I'm gonna ask you to raise your hand. And we're going to pray a real simple prayer together. Are you ready? One, God loves you. Two, he has a magnificent, fantastic plan for your life. And he's already made a way for you in Christ Jesus. Three, raise your hand. Say, that's me. I want to make Jesus the Lord of my life. Raise your hand. You know it. All I'm going to ask is that you believe it in your heart and say it with your mouth. Scripture says, whoever calls the name of the Lord shall be saved. It says to believe in your heart. God raised him from the dead. Make a confession of your faith. He's alive, and you will be saved. You'll receive the life of God. So let's pray this. Repeat after me. Say, God in heaven, I believe in you. I believe you're the creator of heaven and of earth. I believe you sent your son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for my sin. I believe he died and rose again on the third day just for me. I repent of my sin, my mess, my mistakes. But I say, Jesus, you are Lord, and you are more than enough for me. So today, I am forgiven. Today, I'm made new. Today, I'm in the family. God, you are my Father, and I'm one of your kids. Thank you, Lord, for showing me your goodness, your grace, and your mercy. In Jesus' name.
If you would like more information about Christian Worship Center, please visit our website at christianworshipcenter.com.